Spare us, good Lord, spare thy people, whom thou hast redeemed with thy most precious blood, and by thy mercy preserve us forever.
Spare us, good Lord,
from all evil and wickedness, from sin, from the crafts and assaults of the devil, and from everlasting damnation.
Good Lord, deliver us.
From all blindness of heart, from pride, vainglory, and hypocrisy, from envy, hatred, and malice, and from all want of charity.
Good Lord, deliver us.
From all inordinate and sinful affections, and from all the deceits of the world, the flesh, and the devil.
Good Lord, deliver us.
From all false doctrine, heresy, and schism, from hardness of heart, and contempt of thy word and commandment.
Good Lord, deliver us.
From lightning and tempest, from earthquake, fire, and flood, from plague, pestilence, and famine.
Good Lord, deliver us.
From all oppression, conspiracy, and rebellion, from violence, battle, and murder, and from dying suddenly and unprepared.
Good Lord, deliver us.
By the mystery of thy holy incarnation, by thy holy nativity and submission to the law, by thy baptism, fasting, and temptation.
Good Lord, deliver us.
By thine agony and bloody sweat, by thy cross and passion, by thy precious death and burial, by thy glorious resurrection and ascension, and of their labor or their travel.
We beseech thee to hear us, O Lord.
That it may please thee to preserve and provide for all women in childbirth, young children and orphans, the widow, and all whose homes are broken or torn by strife.
We beseech thee to hear us, O Lord.
That it may please thee to visit the lonely, to strengthen all who suffer in body, mind, and spirit, and to comfort with thy presence those who are failing and infirm.
We beseech thee to hear us, O Lord.
Eripiam eo. A reading from the book of Genesis. God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "As for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal of the earth with you, as many as came out of the ark. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." God said, "This is the sign of the covenant that I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, I will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth." God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the first letter of Peter. Christ also suffered for sins once and for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which he also went and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison, who in the former times did not obey, when God waited patiently in the days of Noah, during the building of the ark, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were saved through water, a baptism, which this prefigured now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience, through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers made subject to him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Qui habitat in adiutorio altissimi, in protezione Dei Celi comor abitu. Dicet Dominum, susceptor meus es, et refugium meum, Deus meus, sperabo in eum. Quoniam ipse liberavit me dellaque hovenantium, et a verbo asperum. Scapulis suis ob umbrabit tibi, et sub penis eum sperabit. Scuto circum Davite veritas eius, non timebis a timore nocturnum. Assagita volante per die, a negotio per ambulante in tenebris, a ruina et demonio meridiano. Adent a latere tuo mille, et tecem millia ad extris tuis, tibi autem non apropinquabit. Quoniam angelis suis mandavit ete, ut custodiante in omnibus viis tuis. In manibus portabunt te, neunquam offendas ad lapidem pedem tuum. Super aspidem et basiliscum ambulabis, et conculcabis leonem et draconem. Quoniam in me speravi, liberabo eum, protega meum, quoniam coniovit nomen meum. Invocabit me, et ego exaudiam eum, cum ipso sum in tribulatione. Eripiam eum, et glorificabo eum, longitudine dierum adimplebo eum, et ostendam illis salutare meum.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And just as he was coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens torn apart and the Spirit descending like a dove on him. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I am well pleased." And the Spirit immediately drove him out into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. The Gospel of the Lord.
may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be always acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer.
Amen.
On a Sunday a few weeks ago, I asked you to picture the first chapter of the Gospel of Mark as a gallery of images, each one revealing a distinctive feature of Jesus, the Messiah. I also explained at that time that the image of Christ's temptation in the wilderness would remain veiled until today, the first Sunday in Lent. The veil has now been lifted, and we may be surprised to see not one image, but a series. As we just heard it, the series begins with, and it cannot be understood apart from, the baptism of Jesus, already witnessed by us 6 weeks ago. At the time, we were awed by the heavens being torn open, the descending dove, and the divine words that said of Jesus, "You are my son, the beloved." But here today we read forward and we notice the connection of the baptism to what follows. Jesus was still wet from the waters of baptism when the Spirit drove him out into the wilderness. The next image in our series. As Matthew and Luke render this same story, Jesus is merely led by the Spirit. Our collect for the day uses that same verb. But here, Jesus is driven. The verb is forceful. Jesus is coerced, pushed, compelled. He seems to have no choice in the matter. Some of us may know that feeling, even or especially if we can't explain it to anyone else or even to ourselves. The Spirit seems to have driven us to undertake some work of love or some justice project for God's sake. And we're past the point of believing that we have a choice. We feel we've been driven by the Spirit. The wilderness into which Jesus is driven is laden with ominous, scary, and promising associations echoing down from one generation to another in the people of Israel's lore and scripture. Moses and the burning bush, Jacob's ladder, Elijah and the still small voice, and of course, at the beginning of this and other gospels, John the Baptist quoting Isaiah, "In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord." The wilderness into which Jesus was driven by the Spirit was surely a known place. But first and foremost, it is a terrain of the heart. It's the place where any of us may be driven by the Spirit to contemplate a decision, to sort out the competing clamor of voices in our lives, to let go of some long-standing burden, to to commit to something new. In the wilderness, one's yeses begin with a capital Y. One's no's with a capital N, as Jesus will soon show us. Wilderness may include a necessary ordeal. It may also be a place of blessing, as Jesus will also show us. Some of us may associate these wilderness qualities with a regular summer destination, or a monastery or a convent, or a familiar quiet bend in the shore along Lake Michigan where we sometimes pause. Some of us may have recognized wilderness in the confines of our own homes during this pandemic. We are told that Jesus was in the wilderness for 40 days. But there's no daily journal. Notice how this gospel author describes that time by way of three quick sketches, all compressed into only one verse. Each of these three wilderness sketches is populated with distinctive characters, starting with Satan. Mark does not give us the 11 verses of detail found in Matthew or the 13 in Luke. We must guess from the context that Satan recognized the threat posed by Jesus. Satan immediately seeks to undermine the purity and clarity of divine intention that was on full display at the baptism. And what pure or clear divine intention is Satan even now seeking to attack in us? In the next sketch, Jesus is shown with the wild beast. An image completely unique to this telling of it. Some interpreters imagine that the wild beasts are included here merely as props to heighten the sense of danger in the wilderness. Others see in these wild beasts a primordial reference to the animals that co-inhabited the Garden of Eden with Adam before the creation of Eve and before the fall. In any case, this curious inclusion of the wild beasts with Jesus in the wilderness may lead some of us so inclined to wonder about our own lost or found connections to the created order. So muses W.H. Auden, contemplating the living natural order in the first lines of his poem, Address to the Beasts. For us who, from the moment we first are worlded, lapse into disarray, who seldom know exactly what we are up to, and, as a rule, don't want to. What a joy to know, even when we can't see or hear you, that you are around. After these wild beasts, one final sketch, and the angels ministered to him. The presence of the angels here signify that Jesus has made it through the wilderness ordeal and all that it represents with his divine intention and vocation intact. The angels also suggest a human aspect of Jesus. As in a time of testing and peril, he is in need of divine mercy, aid, and messengers. As is often the case with us. So we've quickly examined five separate images arising from today's gospel passage. They could be titled baptism, wilderness, battling with Satan, wild beasts, and angels. Each image is unique and invites our return for further contemplation. The images are all connected by inviting us into a deeper knowledge and appreciation of Jesus, the Messiah. These images could also be viewed as a guidebook of sorts for us now. The baptism recapitulates the ground we covered in the weeks after the Epiphany, contemplating how we also have been baptized and called. Grant that your people, illumined by your word and sacraments, may shine with the radiance of Christ's glory. So we pray on the second Sunday after the Epiphany. But now we ourselves have been driven by the Spirit into the wilderness of Lent. And here we aspire to a courageous faith, to reckon with our demons, whatever seduces us away from our love of God. Here we may come upon the wild beasts challenging all artifice in our lives, inviting a reconnection to the natural world and our own primal incarnate bodies. And here, knowing we are lost if we struggle alone, we plead to the angels to minister to us, to bless us with messages of God's mercy, love, and unshakable presence with us. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
I invite you to warmly open your hearts, but maintain appropriate distance as we share the peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
I do have some announcements this morning and welcome you to be seated. I hugely regret that I have not made more of a fanfare out of the fact of Deacon George Arsenault's anticipated ordination as a priest this coming Saturday. Yes, it will be socially distanced and it will be live streamed through some link you can find on the website for our diocese. I've waited so long because this was kind of a last minute deal and George only received word in the last 10 days, so we were waiting to get our ducks in a row, but our prayers are with you and bless you. And in addition, Megan Murphy Gill is here today. You can raise your hand because you're masked and others won't recognize you. She will be ordained deacon at the same mass on Saturday. Starting March 1st, we're going to be welcoming her to serve here as a deacon as well. She, as George has been, will be a transitional deacon preparing for ordination as a priest. So I ask for your prayers for Megan and George, for Bishop Doug Sparks driving up from the Diocese of Northwest Indiana to serve as the bishop for the ordinations, and keep them as well and their families in your thanksgivings. I'm sorry for confusion and any misunderstandings or delay with regard to our technology. We are getting close. I'll give you some updates in the newsletter this Wednesday. Gary and Mary Beth and I actually determined that the system is probably good to go this morning, but we didn't want to start with a belly flop on the first Sunday of Lent in the event of a problem. So we'll be working on that and doing some tests in coming days. Fair enough. If there are some of you who are visitors, we're particularly grateful that you've joined us. We wish more than anything that we could greet you at the doors as you leave. Social distancing prohibits us, but we do encourage you to be in touch with us by email or phone call so that we can find a way, if possible, to support you in your faith and answer any questions you have about Church of the Ascension. Thank you.
Scapuli suis, ob umbrabit tibi dominus, et superis eius, sperabis, scuto, circumdabite, veritas eius.
few reminders that we're using Rite 1 during the 5 Sundays of Lent, and you, if unfamiliar, may wish to follow a little more closely in the bulletin with regard to your responses. Secondly, that there are no organ postludes or voluntaries following the end of the Mass, so if you're waiting for it, you'll be here a week. So thank you to our musicians who are working so hard, our organist, choirmaster, and singers, to edify us during this holy season. Pray, my dear brothers and sisters, that this my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Father Almighty.
May the Lord receive the sacrifice at your right hand, to the praise and glory of his name, both for our benefit and that of all his holy church.
Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with our spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Thanks unto our Lord God.
It
is very meet, right, and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee, O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who was in every way tempted as we are, yet did not sin.
do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me. Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us be seated.
We do not presume to come to this thy table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, in thy manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up our crumbs under thy table, but thou art our same Lord, whose priority is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Happy are they who are called to his supper. Lord, I am not worthy that you should come under my roof.
down before the Lord.
Grant, Almighty God, that your people may recognize their weakness and put their whole trust in your strength, so that they may rejoice forever in the protection of your loving providence. Through Christ our Lord.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Mass is ended. Let us go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.